Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Gospel Light Baptist Church, for watching this. And I know that it's difficult not being able to come to church like we want to, but I really appreciate every one of you bearing with us and praying for us. And I really appreciate your willingness to view these YouTube videos. I know that it's not easy. Some of you don't have good connection at home. And so I just appreciate everyone's faithfulness and just bearing with us in this time. And appreciate everyone that's clicked on this link. And I hope everything that's said this morning to be a blessing to you. Amen. I hope, trust everyone's doing well. We're gonna let the girls sing two songs. We went ahead and pre-recorded at the house. The girls sang two songs there, and so we're going to go ahead and listen to at least one of those, maybe two, and then I might have one at the end of the service. I'm not sure what I'll do about that yet, but there'll at least be two. But enjoy this song, and I hope it's a blessing to you.
Thoughts of hurt and pain when I had gone astray. He wanted to discourage me as I walked along my way. He said, "You're undeserving, 'cause I know where you've been. I have a record of your life when you were bound by sin. I know your darkest secrets that you would never tell. What makes you think you don't deserve a place with me in hell?" Well, I heard the old accuser, and this was my reply: "You're right for all the things I've done. You deserve to die. My righteousness is filthy rags. My goodness is unclean. There's only one thing I can say to what you've said to me. It's under the blood. Oh, praise is your name. I'm not what I used to be. My life has been changed. Not shackled by sin and shame. It's already gone. I'm happy reminding him it's under the blood. Victory was given me when I was born again. He washed my stained and sinful past and put new life within. No longer do I bear the mark that sin had brought my way. With happiness and peace of mind, praise God, I now can say, it's under the blood. Oh, praise is your name. I'm not what I used to be. My life has been changed. Not shackled by sin and shame. It's already gone. I'm happy reminding him it's under the blood. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? has been changed, not shackled by sin and shame. It's already gone. I'm happy reminding him it's under the blood.
Amen. That was such a blessing. I appreciate the girls being willing to sing there at the house. And I've got one announcement for sure, and that'll be next week. We're going to try this. We're going to have everyone drive to the church and stay in your cars when you get here. And Lord willing, we're going to have an FM transmitter that we'll be doing services on, and we'll be out on the front porch there. Possibly even have maybe a keyboard or something like that plugged up where we can do some singing prior to the service, and then hopefully I'll be able to preach with a microphone and you can tune into your radio. If we can't do that, if nothing else, I'm going to preach out there, and you can just crack your windows, roll your windows down, whatever the case is. And I'll be loud enough that you can hear me for sure from your cars. And so when we pull up, just make sure that you're 6 feet apart, and or maybe even a little more than that. We got probably plenty of room in the parking lot for that. And so we'll guide you when you come in. There'll be somebody here to help you with that. Amen. All right, well, take your Bibles if you're sitting at home on the couch. Have your Bible ready. Get your Bible. And open your Bible up to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter number 5. And I want to give you what God has put on my heart for this morning. And hope and pray that it'll be a blessing to you. And it'll help you. All right. Ephesians chapter number 5. And I want to begin reading in verse number 16, I guess, is probably a good starting point. Really, not a good place to start, but I'm just going to kind of jump in Ephesians chapter number 5 and verse number 16. The Bible says, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Now, you have to admit that the days that we're living in are evil days. Just look around. And it won't take you long to figure out we're living in evil days today. I believe with all my heart that we're nearing the end. We're nearing the coming of the Lord. And the days are definitely evil, especially in the days here that we're living in and in this quarantine era. And you can just see the evilness in people's hearts and in people's lives. But we are in the midst of all of the evil that is around us. We are to be redeeming the time. And we are to be doing all that we can for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and for the glory of God. We need to be doing everything that we can. The Bible says in verse number 17, wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Now, the will of the Lord is a subject that can be talked about a lot, can be preached about a lot, can be taught about a lot. A lot of people want to know, what is the will of the Lord? Well, here's a real good, this morning, it's a real good indication to you of what the will of the Lord is. Verse number 18, very familiar verse. The Bible says, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Verse number 18 is the verse that I want to deal with this morning. I want to preach on. And I just want to do this. I want to preach on being filled with the Spirit. It's a very, very simple, very, very base subject that we're talking about this morning that we're going to be preaching on. But it is very needed in this time, these days that are evil. We are to be redeeming the time in these days. And the way that we redeem the time to the best of our ability is to be filled with the Spirit of God, to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And those should not be words that scare us, being filled with the Holy Spirit, being filled with the Holy Ghost. being spirit-filled, walking in the Spirit. All of those really are basically the same thing, being filled with the Spirit. And here's what I want to do before I get into the text that I want to look at this morning. I want to give you a couple of things that being filled with the Spirit is not. Being filled with the Spirit is not self-sanctification. There's numerous people, lots of people, that are self-sanctified, but they are not filled with the Spirit of God. And I know you've met them. I've met them. You've met them. We have met people that have self-sanctification. They've in their own selves, they've set themselves apart. We understand that the word sanctification or sanctified is simply this. It is being set apart for the service of the Lord. But there are people who sanctify themselves, self-sanctification. That is not being filled with the Spirit of God. Next thing is, being filled with the Spirit is not separation. And I do believe, we do practice separation. We believe in separation. Separation is a Bible doctrine, but separation in and of itself is not being filled with the Spirit of God. Next thing is, being filled with the Spirit of God is not service. Service. There's a lot of people that are serving, that do exercise service, but they're not filled with the Spirit of God. They're not walking in the Spirit. They're not living a Spirit-filled life. There's also a group of people, a massive group of people, that are sincere, but they're not filled with the Spirit of God. So being filled with the Spirit is not sincerity. You can look at the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses and a lot of other religious people. They're very sincere, but they're very wrong. They're not filled with the Spirit of God. Let me just say this, not in what I was going to say this morning, but it needs to be said. A person cannot be Spirit-filled unless they're saved by the grace of God. Unless you're born again, you cannot be Spirit-filled. It is an impossibility to be Spirit-filled. It's impossible to be Spirit-filled and not be saved by the grace of God. And so I want to look at some verses in the remainder of chapter number 5 and then chapter number 6 that deals with being filled with the Spirit. And I want to do this. I want to deal with the Spirit-filled life. And being Spirit-filled is not just a one-time thing and then maybe every now and then. It should be a life. It should be our conversation. We should be trying to obtain, I guess you could say it that way, we should be trying to obtain a Spirit-filled life all of the time. And so a couple of things, actually more than a couple. I got 5 things this morning that I see in these scriptures about the Spirit-filled life. Number 1, in verse number 18, the Bible says, "But be filled with the Spirit." I see, number 1, a command to be Spirit-filled. The Bible does not suggest to us to be Spirit-filled. It is a command from the Word of God. If you have been born again by the grace of God, if you've been saved, you are commanded from the Scriptures to be Spirit-filled. It is a command, not a suggestion. I wonder this sometimes. I wonder how many professing Christians that really are born again, that are saved, I wonder how many of them either have never been Spirit-filled or maybe have been at one point in their life, but they do not live a Spirit-filled life. It would probably shock us to know how many saved people do not live a Spirit-filled life. I want to. I want to please God. I want to do what the Bible says. I want to be a doer of the Word and not a hearer only. I want to keep the commands of Christ that He's given us in His Word. And I want to make a difference in this world. The only way that we're ever going to truly be able to be the salt that we need to be in this world, to be a sweet savor in the mouth of this world, to be a light in this world, to be a light in a dark world in this evil day that we're living in, the only way that we're really going to be able to redeem the time that we have on this earth is to be spirit-filled. Only way we're going to do that is to be the salt of the earth, to be the light, and to give everlasting water, everlasting life to a thirsty and perverse generation. That's the only way we're going to be able to do that. And the only way to do that is to be spirit-filled. There is a command to be spirit-filled. I want to do this morning. I just want to ask you. I want you to answer this in your heart. I want you to answer. I want you to do this. I guess you can do it now, but definitely at the conclusion of this service, I want you to ask yourself, am I spirit-filled, and do I live a spirit-filled life? Amen. So we have the command to be spirit-filled. But not only do we have the command, we also, in verse number 19, we have the confirmation of the spirit-filled life. In the Word of God, there is a gauge. There is a thermometer. There are ways to tell a lot of the things that the Bible commands us to do. There always is a gauge or a thermometer that will allow us to indicate to ourselves whether we are what the Bible says we are. And in this case, the Bible commands us to be spirit-filled. And so there must be a confirmation. There must be a way that we can tell if we are spirit-filled. Verse number 19 gives us that confirmation. The Bible says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Speaking to yourselves. Now, I know this. I know that there are times, and matter of fact, there's a fellow at work. He goes around. He sings a lot. He's just one of those type people that if you get around him, he's singing something. And when he is around me, he knows I'm a pastor. Knows I pastor this church. And when he is around me at work, he's always singing some kind of gospel music. Most of the time, it's Southern gospel. A lot of it, I don't even know what it is, but I know what he's singing when he sings it. But when he's around other people, it might be a different kind of song. And so, but the Bible says here, speaking to yourselves. Let me ask you this question. When you are by yourself, whether you're driving down the road, whether you're working out in the yard, riding the lawnmower, cutting grass, whatever you're doing. If you're a lady, if you're at home cooking, or you're shopping, or going down the road to go shopping, whatever you're doing in life, then maybe there's no one around. What are you doing in your heart? What kind of song do you have in your heart? That is a good indication of whether you're spirit-filled or not. Now, it's not all-inclusive. I understand that. There's probably people in this world that's not spirit-filled that have a song in their heart, and even a psalm or a hymn or a spiritual song. But in all reality, this is a very good indication of whether you are spirit-filled or not. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, these three things we know, of course, we're very well aware that these three things are the commands that the Bible gives us, or the confines that the Bible gives us of the type of songs that we need to have in our life, not only in the church, but in our life. And let me just, I need to say this, I really do need to say it. If your radio in your car is tuned to, or your CDs in your car, are nothing but the world, the things of this world, they're not biblical songs, it might be a good indication that you're not living the spirit-filled life that you need to be living. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. That to the Lord is a good indication of where you're at. Amen. Not only do we have the command of the spirit-filled life, we have the confirmation of the spirit-filled life, but we have the conduct of the spirit-filled life. In verses number 20 through chapter number 6 and verse number 9, there's a lot of scripture. I'm not going to take the I'm not going to take the time to read all of it. I just want to kind of give you the outline of it. But there is a conduct that the Spirit-filled life brings upon us. And in verse number 20, I'll read a couple of these. Verse number 20 says, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So number one, there is a conduct to the Savior in a Spirit-filled life. Giving thanks always for all things. If we will line up with that, if we will do that, that is the number one conduct that a person that lives a Spirit-filled life will live out. Not only to the Savior, but in verses number 21 through 33, the Bible says in verse number 21, wives, submitting yourselves. In verse number 22, and verse number 23, for the husband, head of the wife. Verse number 25, husbands, love your wives. He goes through, down through this. And so not only do we have the conduct to the Savior, but we also have it to the spouse. Husbands, love your wives. Wives, love your husbands. And so there is a way that we can live out this Spirit-filled life in how we react and how we act to and how we conduct ourselves to our spouse. And then in chapter number 6, I'm skipping a lot of verses. I understand that. I don't have time to get into all these, but I just want to give you the outline. In chapter number 6, the Bible says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother. And all of those, I'm not going to read all those scriptures, but you probably are very well aware of those. So we not only have conduct to the Savior, to the spouse, but also of the siblings to their parents. And let me say this, and because it's not said a lot of kids don't understand this, they don't comprehend this, and they need to. If a young man, if a young lady, if a child really wants to live a Spirit-filled life, if they've been born again, they should want to. And in the home, the children ought to be able to obey their parents. They ought to honor their father and their mother. They ought to be obedient to their parents. And if they are spirit-filled, they will honor their father and their mother. They are going to live. Their siblings are going to live in a way that honors their parents. Not only to the Savior, to the spouse, to the siblings, but in chapter number 6, verses 5 through 8, we have to the servants and to the masters, how the servants obey their masters and how the masters treat the servants. And so this could be, and I understand that in the context of the scriptures, that was in an era that slave owners owned slaves, and there were masters and there were servants. But in this day and age, you could also say this: if you work a job, if you have a boss, if you have an employer, and you are an employee, that this scripture goes for you. This scripture is very applicable to you. And how we treat our employer, and if we're an employer, how we treat our employees is a good indication of whether we are Spirit-filled or not. And if we are Spirit-filled, then we will obey the Scriptures in how we treat our employer and how we treat our employees in those matters. All right, so that's the conduct of the Spirit-filled life. But next we have the course of the Spirit-filled life. In chapter number 6, verses 10 through 18, and I'm not going to read all of these, but I want to look at verse 10 and 11. The Bible says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Not our own might, but in His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So there is the course of the Spirit-filled life. In verse number 11, we read, putting on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand against the wiles of the devil. We're looking at the course of the Spirit-filled life. And in verse number 11, we find who we are fighting against. We're fighting against the devil. The devil is our main adversary. The devil is as a roaring lion that walketh about seeking whom he may devour. The devil is trying his best to figure out a way to get into your life. And so in verse number 11, it tells us who we are fighting against. In verse number 12, it tells us what we are fighting against. We're not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. There is a very real spiritual battle that is taking place in this world against the Christians, against people that are Spirit-filled, people that are not Spirit-filled. You can be carnal, you can be worldly, and be saved, and you're in this battle, but the devil's winning in this battle. Your flesh is winning this battle. The world is winning in this battle that you are in. The only way that we are going to properly be able to defend ourselves against the wiles of the devil, the only way we're going to be able to successfully defend ourselves from the wickedness of this world and the principalities of this world, the rulers of darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in the high places of this world, the only way we're going to be able to do that is if we are Spirit-filled. You say, Brother Jody, why in the world cannot I have victory in my life? I want to tell you something. The way to have victory in this life is to be Spirit-filled. And as a matter of fact, that's the only way that we'll ever have true victory in this life is if we are Spirit-filled. So not only do we have the command, the confirmation, we have the conduct of the Spirit-filled life, the course of the Spirit-filled life. And let me say this, but in the course of the Spirit-filled life, not only do we find out who we're fighting against, we find out what we are fighting against, but also we find out how we are to fight against them. It goes through the whole armor of God. And the only way that we're ever really going to live a Spirit-filled life to the fullest, to the best ability that we can, is to have on the whole armor. Not half of it, not some of it, not even most of it, but all of it. And when we go through these, we look at this armor and we find, number one, that there's truth that we need to arm ourselves with. There is righteousness that we're to armor ourselves with. There is the gospel that we are to armor ourselves with. There is faith. There is salvation. And there is the Word of God. Now, there's a lot of preaching that I can do in these things right here. A lot of preaching that I can do that would take me a long time to get through them. I don't want to do that, but I do want to just say this. The Bible gives us truth to put in our hearts. We are to take the truth of the Word of God and write them upon the tables of our heart. We are to memorize them. We are to remember them. We are to always keep them readily accessible. And if you don't read your Bible, then you're really not going to ever have enough truth in your arsenal to be able to have the whole armor of God, to have the truth, to have righteousness. Now, I understand in this day and age that we live in, the word righteousness is not a very popular word, but it's still right. It is still biblical and it's still doctrinal. We are to be a righteous people. We are to abstain from all appearances of evil. We are to live separated in this present world. We are to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. We are to be a righteous people. We're also to have the gospel. Have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And then we're to have the shield of faith. We're to have the helmet of salvation. We are to have the Word of God. I'm thankful that I have the Bible. I'm thankful I have the Word of God this morning to be able to fight against all the wickedness in this world with. Thank God for the Bible. I was just talking this week to an I guess you could call him an agnostic. He's not an atheist. He believes there is a higher power, but he does not believe that higher power that is out there somewhere has anything to do with mankind. He thinks the Bible is just a sham, and don't believe any of the Word of God at all. I don't even know if he believes it's even a book of situational ethics. But anyway, I was talking to him and trying to witness to him, and it is a wonderful, wonderful thing to have to have readily the Word of God available. I've tried to. I don't carry my Bible to work all of the time. I do sometimes, but I have memorized a lot of Scripture, or I've tried to, and I enjoy when I'm witnessing to someone like that, just quoting Scripture to them. Not giving my opinion, but quoting Scripture to them. And if you'll quote Scripture to someone that is like that, that is a real good way to have the whole armor of God. And then, not only do we have the command, but in verse number 18, we have the conclusion for the Spirit-filled life. In verse number 18, the Bible says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. That if a person would take verse number 18 and apply it to their life, make it applicable in their life, they will be able to successfully live out the Spirit-filled life. They will be able to walk in the Spirit the way the Bible commands us to, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. What a wonderful conclusion this is to live the Spirit-filled life. We ought to be doing that, practicing that. That is a powerful verse that we need to be living out in our lives. We need to be living. There are so many people that rob themselves of being able to live by the Word of God. They rob themselves from the blessings of the Word of God because they do not practice praying always, and they don't engage in the supplication of prayer in the Spirit of God. There is a difference. There is a difference between the kind of praying that we do when we're sitting at the kitchen table and we're asking God to bless the food and say thanks for the food and eat the food with thanksgiving. That there is a difference between that and praying in the Spirit. There is a difference between maybe the 1 or 2 minute prayer that we pray before we go to bed at night or when we wake up in the morning. There is a difference between that and praying in the Spirit. And there have been memorable times in my life that I've been praying in the Spirit, and instead of me communicating with God, God communicates with me. Some of the greatest times that I've ever had in my Christian life was times that I've spent in prayer, in praying in the Spirit. And some of the fondest memories that I have as a Christian has been times that I've saturated my life in prayer. And there's nothing like it in the world. Nothing like calling upon the name of the Lord and knowing that He is hearing you. There is nothing like praying in the Spirit. I wonder this. I wonder how many people go through their Christian life, go through life saved, and never one time really praying in the Spirit. Never really knowing that God has heard them when they're praying. I don't understand how people can go through life and be like that. And in a time when this world has no peace, and in a time when seeming Christians even have no real peace inside, if they would learn that, if they would live a Spirit-filled life, if they would live a life that contained prayer and supplication and watching with all perseverance, if they would understand how important it is to live like that, they would understand that living the Christian life can be a life of joy and peace, and it's wonderful. I'm so thankful that God gives us the privilege of coming to Him in prayer, and God gives us the privilege of Him living inside of us and living through us, and we being able to be filled with the Spirit of God and walk in the Spirit and being full of the Holy Ghost. Thank God for that. That blessing to be able to do that. We could not live this life without being filled with the Spirit and having that whole armor of God on us at all times. We would not be able to successfully live this Christian life. My heart breaks for people who profess to be saved. They sit on our church pews Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and you can tell they're not filled with the Spirit of God. They don't walk in the Spirit. They don't have the whole armor of God. I wish people could understand how important it is to live a Spirit-filled life. How important it is to have the whole armor of God. I'm going to let the girls sing one more song, and I hope this song is a blessing to you.
Troubles come against me, and I feel so overwhelmed. When it seems the more I've tried giving, my troubles seem to swell. And when I've reached the end of me, and my faith is getting dim, oh, I hear a sweet voice whisper, just bring it all to Him. Bring it all to Him. When no one understands, when you're looking for an answer, God always has a plan. And when the burdens get so heavy and my side is getting dim, oh how sweet it is to know that you can bring it all to Him. Throne room of my Savior, I'll find such sweet relief. I'll find strength to bear my burdens. I'll find comfort for my grief. And when my cup is overflowing, when He fills it to the rim, what a blessed consolation when I just bring it all to Him. And I'll just bring it all to Him. When no one understands, when you're looking for an answer, God always has a plan. And when the burdens get so heavy and my side is getting dim, oh how sweet it is to know that you can bring it all to Him. Oh, how sweet it is to know that you can bring it all.